After I pulled Jack off Ed Sanders, we went all around the corner to Anitic's, which is a hot dog stand and whatnot. And I remember Jack gulping down a couple of hot dogs. And after we left Anitic's, we went back to the hotel room. Nick Sampas decided he was going to go and gamble in Brooklyn. So there was the three of us left. We showered up, and that night we decided we wanted to get some jazz. So we went to a jazz club, and again, I try to stay sober. He got stiff and started acting up, and we were asked to leave the jazz club or face the consequences. We hailed a cab, and he picked up a black hooker, and he couldn't perform. But he acted as if he was Macho Man, but there was no performance. And the black hooker insisted on being paid. Jack didn't want to pay her. There was a bit of an argument. We didn't have much money, and I think another compromise, we gave him maybe $15, and we kept the rest because we were down to our last 20 or 30 bucks. We got back to the hotel room, and Jack wanted to drink, which he did all day and all night. The next day, we were invited to have lunch with William Buckley the following day at the Delmonico Hotel. On the way to the Delmonico Hotel, there's a very, very close friend of mine that had moved to New York and had a beautiful restaurant, steakhouse, and bar. So I decided, let's go and say hello to Billy. His name was Billy Kahn, Konstantinakis. So we went in, and like I say, it was a classy place on Lexington Ave, and Jack was dressed like he slept all night in his clothes. He did a shave and looked like a bum. In fact, I think the three of us looked pretty bad. So Billy Kahn greeted me, "How you doing? Good to see you." And he pulled me aside and he says, "Who's this guy?" And I said, "Yeah, that's a writer, a famous writer." And Billy said, "I never heard of him." And he says, "Can we get a couple of drinks?" He says, "Yeah." But he says, "You know, don't stay too long because, you know, this is a real nice dining room." And I said, "A couple of drinks." So Jack had a couple, and then the bartender shut us off. And Jack got a little wild again and made a scene. And Billy had a couple of bouncers. They come over, and Billy had to interfere, and he says, "Get him out of here, will you? And don't bring him back." And that was another bad scene. We finally got to the Delmonico Hotel, to the dining room, and Jack and I went up to the captain, and he stopped us, and I don't blame him. And he said, "Hey, where are you guys going?" He said, "Well, we have an invite by William Buckley to have lunch with him." He said, "Well, you wait here, and I'll be back." So the guy left, come back, and he says, "Look, do yourself a favor. Leave the premises, or you're going to be escorted out by the police." So Jack was highly insulted by it because he really did have a date with William Buckley. It seemed like Buckley denied him the lunch. William Burroughs had a room, I think on the 8th floor of the Delmonico Hotel. So Jack says, "Let's go visit my friend William Buckley." Got in the elevator, we went up to William Buckley's room, and there was Mr. Buckley dressed up in a polka dot blue robe with a red polka dot ascot. And he had some small little glasses on, and he looked to me like Mr. Peepers, and a very, very cordial guy. We were introduced. Then he called up Allen Ginsberg Corso. Hunky, I think Hunky. I think they call him Hunky the Junkie. Myself and Chaput. And of course, the booze come out. And a couple of joints come out, and they started reminiscing about the old days, and about the Beat Generation, and about Mexico, which I found very, very interesting. And we drank and we smoked. Then the conversation turned to me about my fighting, and which I thought was a little ridiculous, and another rap session about my little episode with Fight Game. Finally, Joe Chaput managed to stay sober because he was the driver. We decided it was time to go. We ended up stopping at the Bronx again, at a liquor store. Joe Chaput had a full tank of gas, and we had $22 left. We stopped off in a liquor store, and I remember again Jack buying a six-pack of Michelob, and it may have been a quart of Galliano. Joe Chaput was the driver. Jack and I were in the back seat. We took our shoes off, and Jack ended up with some kind of a pointer that teachers use in school. I don't know where he picked it up and why. It may have been in the car. And he told Joe, you drive, and Billy and I are going to rap in the back. So all the way from the Bronx to Lowell, we drank. We left him there. We left Nick Sampas there because he decided he was going to stay in Brooklyn. And Nick was a big gambler and decided he was going to stay in Brooklyn. And the card games or the poker games would last sometimes 2 or 3 days. And he would manage to get back. So like I said, on the way back, there was just the three of us. We finished the Galliano and the six-pack by the time we get back to Lowell. We met Tony Sampas at Nicky's, and he asked me, how'd everything... Oh, on the way down, Jack was... we were rapping back and forth, and Jack says, I'm going to write a book about this trip to New York, he says. He says, yeah, and you may be the star attraction.
Cool. Please
stop me. Say it all. A book about me and Joe Chaput and Nick Sampas and the whole trip. Every time Joe Chaput would try to get into the conversation, Jack would hit him on the head with the pointer and tell him, look, pay attention to driving and never mind our conversation. Finally, we got to Lowell, and Jack was stiff again, and Tony Sampas met us there, and he said, how'd it go? I said, pretty good, which was a lie. And he says, did you keep him sober? I said, well, how are you going to keep this guy sober? You know, you either knock him out, or... He says, well, I thought I told you to keep him sober. I says, Tony, you know, I'm no Superman. I can't stop a guy against his will. So finally, when I think it was a few days later, the reviews come out of the William Buckley Show, and they weren't that good about Jack. Tony Sampas got a hold of me. Oh, it was taped too. And Tony Sampas got a hold of me, and he reprimanded me about me not keeping him alert.